I'd like to invite your attention this morning to our scripture reading. Today's reading comes to us from the letter to the church of Ephesus, commonly called Ephesians. You'll find Ephesians between the letter to the churches of Galatia, which is commonly called Galatians, and the letter to the church of Philippi, which is commonly called Philippians, in the second section of the Bible that we commonly call the New Testament. Ephesians has traditionally been considered a letter written by the Apostle Paul, but likely it's not written by Paul. Our reading today is found on page 192 in the Pew Bible, and if your Bible is on your electronic device or tablet, you'll find it on the same page. Reading from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 11 through 22. So then, remember that at one time you Gentiles by birth, called the uncircumcision by those who are called the circumcision, a physical circumcision made in the flesh by human hands, remember that you were at that time without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now, in Christ Jesus, you who once were far off have been brought near by the blood of Christ. For he is our peace. In his flesh he has made both groups into one and has broken down the dividing wall. That is the hostility between us. He has abolished the law with its commandments and ordinances, and that he might create in himself one new humanity in place of two, thus making peace, and might reconcile both groups to God in one body through the cross, thus putting to death that hostility through it. So he came and proclaimed peace to you who were far off and peace to those who were near. For through him both of us have access in one spirit to the Father. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are citizens with the saints and also members of the household of God, built upon the foundation of the apostles and prophets, with Christ Jesus himself as the cornerstone. In him the whole structure is joined together and grows into a holy temple in the Lord, in whom you also are built together spiritually into a dwelling place for God. Blessings on this reading of Holy Scripture this morning. There's a lot of mathematics in our sermon today. How many of you remember new math? If you were, unfortunately, an elementary or middle school student of the late 60s and early 70s, maybe even the early 60s, there was this initiative called New Math that was to teach and train us into being scientists that could defeat the Red Scare of communism through having better science, technology, engineering, and design. But for parents of that time period, it was like a whole other country and time, and why the heck are we learning math this way? I wasn't taught this way. Similar thing happened to Amanda and I when Patrick got into elementary school. There's now Common Core math standards. And let's just say, between Amanda and I, neither one of us could recognize how Patrick was coming up with his solutions to his problems. Thank God we live in a time where YouTube makes everything possible. Because there was no way, and we were watching him do his math calculations and counting with fingers and going, we had these things memorized. Why do you need to know how we got to it? I just put it in my head, this is the number, this is the correct thing. Oh no, Dad, we need to group. Okay, group whatever you want to do, but hello, 27 plus 9 is 36, and I didn't have to group anything to do that. I despise math. I'll just be honest with it. That's why I married a mathematician, so I don't have to deal with it that much. But in this scripture reading this morning, we have a strange math equation here. God's math seems to be completely outside of algebra, trigonometry, calculus, or any of the new maths we may have, because for the writer of Ephesians, God's new math equation is very simple. 2 = 1. Now, we have two groups of people here that are mentioned in our scripture. The circumcision, which are Jewish believers who yet recognize Jesus as the Messiah, and then the uncircumcision, which are the Gentile believers, who through Jesus have become blood brothers to the Jewish believers through the blood of Christ. 2 = 1. But clearly in our passage today, there's some kind of dividing wall between 2 = 1. This wall of hostility, as it's called. Now, lots of paper and ink has been spilled as to what this was exactly. But I think it was very simple. It was the difference of cultures between Jews and Gentiles. We don't live like Jews. Gentiles don't. Jews don't live like Gentiles. Therefore, we obviously can't be together. So we set up this wall. Because the rituals and the expectations of the Jewish faith were apparently causing a little bit of hostility between the two groups. And sometimes it's true with us that those things which give us comfort, that are habits of our own making, often become a cause of division and hostility. And yet, unfortunately, they often still will divide what God is trying to unify and what God is trying to reconcile as a new common humanity instead of two different groups. After all, in all of life, there are always two different groups. Let's call them for what they are. A group that would be called insiders, and a group that is called outsiders. Jason Butterick, 20 years ago, was an outsider to the Beaumont High School football team. Praise God for that. The football team was outsiders of Jason Butterick's math and scholastic bowl team. Much that he hated math. Therefore, I was yet an insider to some who were outside. And all of you have experienced at one point in your life being an outsider to an insider group, or now live as an insider, difficultly responding to an outsider wanting to get in. We are, after all, a group gathered here as former outsiders of God that now are insiders of God. in the very household of God, as the writer of our scripture today says. So we need to make sure that our efforts as insiders still make outsiders welcome, never leaving them outside of whatever little walls we have put around for ourselves to define this is the inside group, those are the outside group. There's an interesting statement in our reading this morning that says Jesus is our peace. Today we think of peace as the absence of war, as going along to get along. But these words, Jesus is our peace, he is our peace, means something is not our peace. Who was the rival at that time to peace? Often it was declared that the Roman emperor was your peace. The writer here is making a political statement that would, if he'd been caught, likely have brought death and condemnation, at least, from the authorities and powers that be in that time and in that place. Because this is declaring that a new kingdom of God is not created just by emperors and their armies, but rather this group is created from the blood and bone of someone who was yet condemned by those same emperors and armies. Yet the condemned criminal of empire has become the exalted King of Kings for this new gathering of humanity in our place. So we're called here not just to have a nice weekly timeout place where we pretend that peace is almost possible by sitting near people that, frankly, we would otherwise avoid Monday through Saturday if we could. But rather, this peaceful kingdom of God, it will always bring together diverse and disparate people. The world always seeks to divide for its own powers and for its own purposes. We gather from different times and different places, from different experiences and different statuses, and yet the church still is, to this day, a place where the oddly different can still yet gather in unity. One community that is probably the only place where it's possible to encounter different people, to encounter different beliefs, and to encounter different values regularly. After all, it's through going from outsider to insider that we learn who we really are. The answer is still always two equals one. Because there are, after all, no insiders nor outsiders in God's house. We're not called to uphold all the boundaries that we see around us every day, all the boundaries that are tied up with our age, all the boundaries that are tied up with our economics, all the boundaries that are set up for our politics to work, or any of the other isms that are around us. Because all those isms are a failure to love the other in our midst. And all of those isms operate as walls to this day. There is no them and us. They're all us's, shall we call it, in very poor English. We are called therefore, to build spiritually with one another a dwelling place for God. Notice that last phrase in our scripture. It doesn't say the dwelling place of God, as if there is one definitive, final, absolute, one place where God dwells. But it seems that God operates in many dwelling places. And we all have the opportunity to be truly a dwelling place for God. Prairie is just one of many dwelling places. May we who follow a God who breaks down all walls, that steps out of our comfort zones, that proceeds to gather those whom we at times socially denounce, gather from far and near those who are called saints to the household of God. Thanks be to God for his blessings, that there are no thems, that there's just us, loved as God has already loved us. 2 = 1. Amen.